14 years ago. I'm working critical X emergency medicine. It's a very nice summer day. Not a patient in the ER. 70 degrees outside. It's warm, beautiful. The EMS radio goes off. Westfield Fire Department. We have a 16-year-old that's been hit by a train. And my first thought is, okay, you get hit by a train, you're not viable, you're going to die on the scene. Okay, that's my first thought. And second thought was, this time I had a 15-year-old. So a 16-year-old hit by a train, same age as my son. And every part of me is like, okay, well, if you get hit by a train, you're not going to be viable, you're not going to live. And it's not uncommon when that would happen where the EMS wouldn't transport. So I'm sitting by the radio like, they're not going to transport, they're not going to transport. Please don't transport. Please don't transport. They're not going to transport. Please don't transport. So I hear, you know, we're kind of glued to the radio, right? Because we hear the fire department go. We hear they're on scene. Westfield Hospital, we're transporting. And I'm like, shit. Okay, so they're bringing this 16-year-old in as a trauma code. And once again, thinking about it, goosebumps. You know, I have a 15-year-old and I was so afraid that I was going to see my son come in. I was afraid of that. So I'm gowned up and gloved up, and I got the mask on. I'm ready for the trauma code. I'm here doing CPR on this kid. And they whipped this kid in. And right away, he was big. He was a really big kid. Like, he was like a man. He didn't look like my son at all. And even though his age was close, he was a big boy. He had to be 200 pounds, right? So we go in the room, and we start working this trauma code. And I do everything I can. He's just not viable. I needle his chest, make sure there's no tensions. And this kid, he's got gray matter coming out of his head. He's not viable. He's dead. Okay. I pronounce the code, and now I got to prepare to tell the parents. Okay, so quickly the scene opened up where apparently EMS told me he got into a fight with his mom, and he got sent to his room. Well, he went and met with a bunch of his friends. They went by the railroad tracks, and they jumped in front of a train. Like, I didn't get the impression it was a suicide. I get the impression it was just kids doing something stupid, okay? So I have to wait for mom to come in and break the news that her son died, okay? And I'm very fragile. Now, all of a sudden, a kid comes to triage, and he's screaming. He's lanceating. He's screaming because he witnessed this. This is acute stress response. So, like, they triage him, and I can't deal with him because I got to deal with mom. I'm watching the EMS door because that's where she'd come in. He's over here in the code, the trauma room that I just pronounced. The door is closed. And I'm like, I can't deal with this kid right now. Put him over here. So he's screaming out of my left ear, right? And another kid comes in, and he's screaming too. And I can't deal with them right now. I got to tell mom. So this goes on. And a third kid came in, and they're putting him on this side of the ER. They're closing the doors. The nurses are doing everything they can to console these kids, but I can't do anything yet. 45 minutes go by. There's no mom. This makes no sense to me, right? Well, finally the phone rings. Now the nurses are tied up, and I pick up the phone. Westfield Hospital, can I help you? And they're like, hey, this is a trauma. This is Hammett Trauma Center. Yeah. They said, we have the mother here, the kid hit by the train. Are you transporting? And I said, he died. And all of a sudden, I know what happened. The mom rushed in, where's my son? And the nurse like, hold on, let me call Westfield. They call. Oh, she said, I'm going to send mom up. So I got to wait another half an hour. Okay, I'm dealing with all this. I can't deal with these kids that are screaming. Bottom line is, when mom came in, I mean, when mom came in, she sat in the little roomy triage. When I told her son died, she screamed. She just screamed. Pierced me. Still pierces me. I hear her. She screams. You know. She screams. And I made it a habit whenever I pronounced someone dead, I would walk them back. So I walk her back. I walk her back to her son, and she's just mourning like only a grieving mother could mourn, right? I was the worst case of my career, man. It was so bad. And I got to tell you guys, to be very transparent and humble, you know, I've been in combat action in the Marines. I shot at people. I've been shot at. I've seen war casualties. But I never had horror. I never had post-traumatic stress from war. I work on the ambulance. I had bad cases. I never had anything like this. Anything like this. I could still hear her scream. Okay. I still hear it now. I mean, that weekend I'd take my son to a hockey tournament up in Canada, and I could just hear mom scream. I couldn't sleep. I kept reliving this. It was horrible. It still is horrible. I got back to work that next shift, and the nurse was on him. It was Becky. And I said, Becky, I got to talk to you about that case. And her and I struggled a little bit personally, personality-wise. And I said, and she had about four times as experience that I had as a PA. I said, Becky, I got to talk to you about this case. How bad was this case on a scale from 1 to 10? And she said, nothing's been worse. It hit her just as bad as it hit me. You know, so we went through debriefing where we sat and talked. We didn't have professional debriefing, but we were really close. I went to this kid's wake to find some degree of closure. You know, I went through the greeting line. I hugged them up. I'm very thankful for that case. I'm thankful for the lesson I got from it. I mean, that was a really bad case. Obviously, it's still heavy. But I was able to work through it. I worked through it as appropriately as I could between the debriefing and going to the wake. Like, it doesn't haunt me now. When I tell the story, it does. Okay, so it's heavy now, revisiting with you guys. So why am I doing this? I'm thankful that I went through this because I understood a little bit more of post-traumatic stress, just a very little. And I said it with so much humility. Like, who am I? Like, this is just one kid who got hit by a tree. Like, it's nothing compared to some of our combat veterans who've seen what they've seen or some of the assault cases out there. So I say this with humility that I come to you and say, maybe I have a little understanding now, maybe a little bit. Maybe I have no idea. I just know that this case strikes me in the heart. So what am I sharing with you? I don't believe it adversely affects me, and I don't believe I haven't appropriately worked through it. I would say this to you guys. If you have a bad case, get help. Get help. It will come back to haunt you if you don't. Now, I had a little bit of success as a PA, as a lecturer, as an entrepreneur, but I've had dark days, okay? And I wrote a book about it called Before the Calm. I heard people say, if you really want to help people, tell people your story. Okay, and then see me for life. You know, we were able to grow this business to an Inc. 5,000 business 2 years in a row. And an entrepreneur said, if you really want to help people, tell people your story. So I wrote this book called Before the Calm. So what was my life like before it became calm? What was it like before January 5th of 2011? Well, I can tell you that when I was in my late teens, I saw my brother get shot, by a jealous boyfriend. He didn't die, but the bullet did go through his arm. It fragmented. Part of it went to his chest. He collapsed the lung. He didn't die. But to witness your brother get shot, that can really, really mess you up. And for the longest time, I didn't think it messed me up. I didn't think it did. But that's why I went in the Marine Corps. That's why I just wanted to fight. That's why after that, I just wanted to fight everybody. That's why throughout my whole career, I've had this little bit of attitude, this little edge that at times didn't serve me at all. At times, I'm fighting something that was incredibly unhealthy because I didn't heal it. And I did eventually heal it. I did eventually heal it, and I went through a process, and I'm super thankful for that. But when I look back through my life, I had this scar that I didn't heal. And therefore, I vented out in very unhealthy ways, all because of an unhealed trauma. And what I'm saying to you, colleagues, is this. You know, bad cases will happen if you work in emergency medicine long enough. Any kind of medicine, you're going to have bad cases. Know that, though, there are resources to work through it. You work through it a healthy way, and then you grow spiritually and emotionally, or you don't. And it can become toxic, and that's my experience. Okay, my experience is bad shit happens. Welcome to the game of life. How are you going to deal with it? You know, for the longest time, I dealt with it through denial. Let me pretend it didn't happen. But my behavior was still coping with something. So, John Belinsky from See Me for Life, our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. If you work emergency medicine, urgent care, for me, it was an identity. I loved it. I loved it. And I loved teaching. And I love teaching emergency medicine, urgent care. I love teaching about empathy, patient education. I'll teach in the ACLS and sepsis and all that good stuff. Our urgent care courses are fantastic. Okay. Not for nothing. At one of our recent urgent care courses, we had a gentleman from SEAL Team 1, Navy SEAL, and we've had Navy SEALs at three of the four of our last urgent care courses, and the last Navy SEAL said, John, we're talking about your courses because your stuff is so practical. You're going to get more special ops guys, and I'm getting more and more special forces at our courses because they see the practicality of it. So, John Bosky, proceeding for life. Good luck. God bless. If there's anything I can do, please reach out. We have CME programs. We have videos. We have books. Our live conferences are fantastic. We're doing a conference coming up in Puerto Rico, our emergency medicine course. It's an urgent care course. Consider joining us in Puerto Rico, and it will be – and all of our live conferences, guys, they're only in the mornings, okay? They're from 7 in the morning until 12:30. So you can enjoy these incredible locations with your spouse, with your loved one, or just network with some of your colleagues. We have a really good time. You will come to a conference – as a participant, you'll leave as friends, colleagues with an unbelievable network. And our last conference, our last urgent care course, we had a guy who he basically said, hey, listen, this is the sixth conference of John I've come to. He's come to six of our conferences because the value is there. Good luck and God bless.